who by your own great power and outstretched heart created all things. Well, there is none like you. There is none like you. Well, there is none like you. Well, there is none like you. Well, there is none like you. There is none like you. Truly, God, there is none like you. There is none like you. Well, there is none like you. Well, there is none like you. There is none like. Oh, there is none like you, oh God. Oh, there is none like. With all my being, I'll praise you, oh God. With all my being, I'll praise you, mighty Lord. God, my Savior, King, oh, forever. There is none like. Oh, there is none. Oh, pour out that offering on him this morning. Give him your best, your heart. All you want is our heart, oh Lord. All you want is all of us. So we give it freely, 'cause you gave it freely. Lord, you give it freely. Let the praise come out from the inside. Let the praise come out from the inside. Oh, we worship. Oh, 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 we love you, Lord. Oh. Like you, oh God. There is none like you, oh Lord. There is none like you, oh God. There is none. Oh, you make the broken whole. You set the captives free. You make the broken whole. You set the captives free. Oh, oh. Come on, saints, this morning, those of you who know how to praise with more than just a mouth. The mouth is good, but he looks for those who worship him in spirit, by the Holy Ghost. You know, so many people, all they've known is religion. All they've known is just a plastic Jesus. Something, a window stain on a steeple or a church with Jesus hanging there on the cross. And for many, all they will know about Jesus is what they see in you. And those that come in here, oh, I tell you, when God's people get excited about living for him, about worshiping him, when the reality strikes your soul of the freedom that He purchased, the liberation that He's given us. You know, Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd. I laid down my life for the sheep. How He laid down His life for us. Took the mockings, took the scoffings, took the punches, took everything so that we might go free. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I pray that every heart be made barren and wide open this morning to receive the good word of God, to receive the miracle supply. For truly there is much more, as I started off exhorting you. How Jesus, He's the living God. He's the King of Kings. And so many people, all they've known is religion. All they've seen is religion. I love how Pastor Mark says it, religion. Where they come in on a Sunday morning and they get their little high. And God forgive us for all those who have just seen that. Where we say we're followers of Jesus Christ. And it's nothing but dead religion. But I pray I stir you up this morning. For the people that live just like Jesus. The people who walk just like Jesus. Who talk just like Jesus. Who give their all just like Jesus. Oh, give a shout of praise. Yola tu maya tu keshaya tu shaya. Oh, I speak to every heart. I speak to every life. In the name of Jesus, the things that have held you in bondage will no more hold you in bondage. But the light and light of the gospel will shine upon you, that you have the revelation and come to know the true, the one, the only living God, Jesus Christ. Oh, the living God who's the same yesterday, today, and forever, whose promises fail not. Not one word that He spoke is gonna fail. Not one jot, not one dot. He's called us in, and He's keeping us in that place. Oh, Sunya. Sometimes I just try to hold back because I just want to start going crazy up here. I pray some of you get crazy for God. Come on, some of you got crazy for the world. Some of you got the real party thing, whatever that is. Just want to be crazy for God. The radical for God. The remnant for God. Oh! Because nothing a man's going to change a thing. But only God and the church. The church that takes its place. The church that rises up, we are the answer. We are the answer to everything. Nothing of man, nothing of politics. We are the solution because we don't serve an idol. We don't serve a plastic Jesus. We serve a living God whose blood ran down, blood and water poured from His side, that we can live by Him. And He calls us. And I just plead with you. Some of you think you know it, and you do not. Blood and water flow. That life supply. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus is what makes me dance. When I begin to sing about Jesus' blood bought my soul. Jesus' blood made me whole. Jesus' blood rescued and redeemed. Because it's real to me, I recognize it's not just some creed, some words written in a book, but it is living, it is alive. So I pray some of you get made alive, where you look alive, you move alive, just like Jesus Christ. Welcome this morning. Welcome this morning. All of you new people, welcome. Visitors, welcome. We're just about Jesus. We're just about pouring out the praise, the offering of our lives on Jesus. And that expression where Sunday morning, every meeting that we have, it's our chance to worship Jesus together, to bring Him. Ha ha. I normally wouldn't say this, but I could see those of you who have been living for Jesus, who have been bringing something to Jesus. Because when you have and you're living your life for Jesus, there's more than just a blank stare. And more than just a blank stare. Praise God. But His word is living. Let it come alive on the inside. Let it chop you up to where there's nothing of the flesh left, but only the Spirit of the living God. Oh, I thank you for the fire of the Holy Ghost on this place, Lord. I thank you that you raise up the valiant, the good soldiers who know how to stand and doing all to stand. I just plead with you one more time. Make bare your heart. Bow low. Shut down everything of your mind. Open up your spirit so you can receive that flow. Jesus met the woman at the well who could not get satisfied with the pleasures of this world and the pleasures of this life. And Jesus looked at her and said, I've got a gift to give you. I've got water that never run dry. You'll never be thirsty again. And unfortunately, those many who have just known religion, they've never drank of the water that never runs dry. They've never drank of the supply. But praise God, He has those people. The people who know their God and who do exploits. Oh, abiding place. We are the light to a generation. And many will come in many nations. We'll be gathered around as a gift to present our Savior. And I will ask you this question to stir hunger. What have you brought to Jesus this morning? What have you brought to Jesus? You bring your life? Did you bring an offering? I'm going to say this one last thing before I turn off the Pastor Ann. You know when the woman came in and began to give Him the kisses and that offering of washing Jesus' feet with her tears, there was that breaking, that brokenness, that offering. And I believe it was Simon. He said, Simon, when I, because these guys were like, oh man, this is just, if Jesus knew what kind of woman this was, if He knew what was going on in their all religious self, right? Oh man. It's just the pouring out. It's the pouring out, something that's real. Jesus looks for more than just her words, but a heart of worship. A heart of worship. And I pray this morning that what do I have to bring to Jesus becomes not just a religious notion, just a rhetorical question, just something that's routine, but what do I have to bring to Jesus? We don't know the end of our days. In the psalm that's recorded of Moses, Psalms 90, He says, teach us to number our days, and we apply our heart to wisdom. Teach us to number our days, for as James says, our life is but a vapor. We do not know what
time our life will be required of us. And it's so amazing that the God of all, who laid down his life for us and bloodied himself, gave, just his body was torn up, gave himself for us so that we could live. So that we could live in this life. What do you have to bring to Jesus this morning? He gave his all for us. And he's raising up a group of people in a church that says, I'm done with the pretend. I'm done with singing the song, take all of me, when it's just 1% of me. But hallelujah, he's raising up a people that want truth. And demand reality. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want everyone in this place, I want you to raise your hands, please. Just raise them up there. Maybe you don't know what this means, but it's just saying, hey, God, here I am. It's this posture of saying, hey, I got no defenses. I'm not got the block. I don't got a block going on. I'm not holding on. It's a posture of yieldedness and surrender. All he's looking for is a surrender. I don't want everyone in this place to say, Lord Jesus, I give myself to you. For you gave yourself to me. I will live for you from this day forward and be a testimony of your word. I will not be a false witness. I give my life. I give my all. For you are worthy of it. Oh Lord, you who see. You don't have to repeat this with me. Lord, you who see that compared to you our life would be worthless. The laying of our life down would be as nothing to some. But to you it's so precious. It's so precious. It's so precious to you. It's so precious that you paid the highest price. Thank you, Jesus. There's change going on in the hearts right now. There's change. There's the stirrings of the Spirit. There is the realms of heaven that go beyond the seen realm. There is the Spirit of God, the supernatural. Ah, no, my, yashike, te, she, te. Oh, the Father's love. I got to share one last thing that speaks to the love of my Savior, that is a testimony of my Savior forever. That speaks of the Father, God Almighty, Yehovah God, the creator of all things, who everything came into existence by his word. When Jesus gives us the parable of the prodigal son, and there's that son that goes, spends all the wealth that was his inheritance, and Jesus basically becomes worthless. We see him come back, and how the Father ran out there. He didn't wait. The Father saw him from afar off. He saw him from afar off. And he went running. He went sprinting after him. God says, draw near to me and I will draw near to you. That prodigal son just came, said, I'm going to, you know what, I finally recognize after all, I've just made myself worthless. I finally recognize that if I could just go back, if I could just be one of those servants, I'm going to be in a good place. He begins to draw near to that, to his father. And the father sees him and runs after him. That's the God I serve. That's the God I serve. The God who there's no differences of weight in judgment. He's the same he was then. He's the same he is now, and he doesn't change. He doesn't hold a new standard. He holds the same standard because he is the living God. He's a holy God looking for a holy people. He wants to make you holy. He wants to make you holy. I'm going to stop now or else I'll keep going. Welcome with me, Pastor Ann. She's going to be delivering the word. May your hearts be wide, wide open to receive the things heaven has for you and you and you and each one of you.
Well, Pastor Joshua just stirred up a love song in me. Whew. Draw me, Lord, and I will run after you. Voice of my beloved only I will hear. Rose of Sharon, lily of the valley, no greater joy I've found when you are near. Rose of Sharon, lily of the valley, no greater joy I've found when you are near. Many waters cannot quench my love for you, nor great flood could ever come and drown it. My beloved and my friend, forever love that has no end. While I've breath, I'll sing and shout about it. From your wellspring I drink living waters. Thirst is quenched and soul it is refreshed. Kisses from your mouth, most sweet to me. Heart is ravished only with your love. Kisses from your mouth, most sweet to me. Heart is ravished only with your love. Many waters cannot quench my love for you, nor great flood could ever come and drown it. My beloved and my friend, forever love that has no end. While I've breath, I'll sing and shout about it. While I've breath, I'll sing and shout about it. Draw me, Lord, and I will run after you. Voice of my beloved only I will hear. Rose of Sharon, lily of the valley, no greater joy I found when you are near. Rose of Sharon, lily of the valley, no greater joy I found when you are near. Many waters cannot quench my love for you, nor great flood could ever come and drown it. My beloved and my friend, forever love that has no end. While I've breath, I'll sing and shout about it. While I've breath, I'll sing and shout about it. From your wellspring I drink living waters. Thirst is quenched and soul it is refreshed. Kisses from your mouth, most sweet to me. Heart is ravished only with your love. Kisses from your mouth, most sweet to me. Heart is ravished only with your love. Many waters cannot quench my love for you, nor great flood could ever come and drown it. My beloved and my friend, forever love that has no end. While I've breath, I'll sing and shout about it. While I've breath, I'll sing and shout about it. Hallelujah. That was much lower than it's supposed to be, so it's very difficult. Hallelujah. We welcome everyone. You may be seated. The title of this message this morning is Set Thine House in Order. So we're going to climb a mountain this morning. We're going to start work up to the crescendo, but we're going to start at base camp. So open your Bibles to Luke chapter 4. We're just going to read the first two verses. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. And in those days he did eat nothing. And when they were ended, he afterward hungered. Jesus was victorious, as the chapter continues on, in every single temptation. He was victorious over the devil because, first and foremost, he was full of the Holy Ghost. His physical body was empty because it said he didn't have any food. He didn't have any food for 40 days. But his spirit man was full. Hallelujah. The second thing he did to cause him to be victorious was he quoted the word of truth and annihilated every lie that Satan had, because we know that Satan is the father of lies. So in Hebrews 5:8 says, though he were a son, yet he learned obedience through the things that he suffered. That sounds like suffering to me, being in the wilderness and not having food for 40 days. So the first Adam was placed in a Garden of Eden. But when sin entered into the world through disobedience, the sinless one, the spotless lamb, was then subjected to everything that you and I are subjected to. The Spirit didn't lead Jesus into a lush tropical garden with fruit trees laden with fruit. He led him into a wilderness. A dry, barren, desolate wilderness. So Jesus was fasting those 40 days. We know he ate no food. So physically, we know that his body had to have been weak. You know how it is. One day going on a fast sometimes seems like you've been on a 40-day fast, right? So Jesus showed us by example that the physical strength had nothing to do with his ability to overcome the devil. It was the power of the Holy Spirit. It was the power of speaking forth the word of truth. In Revelation 21:7, it says, he that overcometh shall inherit all things. It is the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of the word of God that causes us to overcome all things. 1 John 5:4 says, whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory, even our faith. We know the just shall live by faith in Habakkuk 2:4, in Romans 1:17, in Hebrews 10:38. There's three witnesses that the just shall live by faith. Romans 12:9 and 21 says, abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Micah 6:8 says, he has showed me, O man, what is good and what the Lord does require, not optional, require of thee, but to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with our God. In John 16:33, we're just going to go through some verses here so that the word will not return void. John 16:33 says, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation. In the world, we are not of the world. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. 1 John 4:4, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 3, Paul said, but I fear, lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. You can't get any simpler than this. Jesus has no darkness in him. Satan has no light in him. Jesus can only proclaim truth. Satan can only proclaim lies. Oh, thank you, Lord. Romans 15:29, Paul said, I shall come in the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ. How can we come in the fullness of the blessing? That's power packed, of the gospel of Christ. It's easy. 1 John 4:17, the King James Version says, as he is, so are we in this world. Queen Anne's version is, as Jesus is, so are we Jesus in this world. So what punctuation mark would you have after that verse concerning you? Would it be an exclamation point? Yes! Yes, that's me! I am Jesus in this world. Or would it be a question mark? I've got doubt and unbelief. I'm not sure. I've really been coming under that condemnation thing. I'm not sure if I'm Jesus in this world. Or would it be an ellipsis? The dot, dot, dot. Sometime in the future, I'll be like Jesus in this world. I'll act like him, but I don't want the accountability now. I pray every one of you would have the exclamation point. After as Jesus is, so are we Jesus in this world. God demands divine order in this divine nature. And the key to fulfilling 1 John 4:17 and be Jesus in this world is to be a doer and a hearer of 2 Kings chapter 20, verse 1. It's quoted identically in Isaiah 38, verse 8, and that's what this message is all about this morning. Set thine house in order. That is the only way that you can mature into Ephesians 4:13, coming to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Not the Christmas Jesus that's the little babe in swaddling clothes in a manger with barn animals around him, right? So Proverbs 24:3 says, through wisdom an house is built, and by understanding it is established. The foundation is key to any solid structure. So I pray your foundation is the Ephesians 2:20 foundation, built upon the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. Hallelujah. The greatest vision to have in your life, without a vision, the people perish, is to be the greatest personification of Jesus Christ in this earth. 1 John 2:6 says, he that saith he abideth in him, we're called the abiding place. Do we live up to our name? Are we the exclamation point, the question mark, or the dot, dot, dot? Ought himself so to walk, even as he walked. Jesus Christ is our greatest example. 1 Peter 2:21 says, for even hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps. John 15:4, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. I think of this verse every time summer comes around, and they've got grapes at Costco, and I'm eating those grapes. I'm like, this is the John 15 message, you know. I'm living it. I'm except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except you abide in me. Jesus promises an endless hope. Satan promises a hopeless end. Matthew 11:29 says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. In heart, as Joshua was talking about the heart. And you shall find rest unto your souls. Almighty God demands divine order in every single area of our lives and our house. Jesus took a whip to all that were out of order in Father's house and brought it back into order. Will you be that zealous to keep your house in order? His house was a house of prayer. Is your house a house of prayer? God is beholding your order. Colossians 2:5 says, "For though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ." God beholds everything. Go read Psalm 139. He knows you're down sitting. He knows you're uprising. There's not a word in your tongue that he doesn't know altogether. And best of all, it says he's acquainted with all your ways. You need to get acquainted with all of his ways so you can properly represent him in the earth. You are to look like heaven. You are to talk like heaven. You are to look like Jesus. You are to talk like Jesus. Matthew 8:8, speak the word only. So the Old and New Testament shows us numerous examples of men and women who had their house in order. We know that Noah had his house in order and he saved his whole house from the flood. Abraham had his house in order. Joseph in Genesis 41 is described of saving his house from 7 years of famine and keeping them alive during that famine from starvation. Hebrews 11 is a chapter all about those that had their houses in order. If your house is in order, you will not have fire hurt you. The flood will not drown you, and no lions will eat you up. Isaiah 43:2-3 says, "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by my name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel." The five wise virgins had their house in order. So I warn you, when the 1 Thessalonians 4:16 and 1 Corinthians 15:52 trumpet sounds, unless your house is in order, you will not go up. So why set your house in order? This is why. Because of who you have in your house, your earthly tabernacle. Hebrews 3:6 says, "But Christ is a son over his own house, whose house are we? If we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end." Jesus is our endless hope. Jesus is in our house. We are the temple of the Holy Ghost. 1 Corinthians 3:16, 6:19. 2 Corinthians 6:16, speak of it. And the Father is in our house. So 2 Corinthians 3:2 says that we are living epistles, known and read of all men. As Pastor Joshua was saying, you may be the only Bible that people see. You may be their only testimony of this life in Christ. We are ambassadors representing the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We are the 1 Peter 2:9 people. We are a chosen generation. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. A royal priesthood, a peculiar people. Oh my. A holy nation to show forth the praises of him who has called us out of darkness into his glorious light.
Hallelujah.
So my house must be in divine order in my inner man, my spirit man, in the following: my study of the word, my daily bread, my prayers, my holy conversations, my thought life, my servitude. I love 2 Corinthians 12:15. It says, "And I will very gladly be spent and be spent for you." My hospitality, my holy emotions, my deeds, my attitudes, my giving of thanks. See, I could spend a lifetime on this set your house in order message. So we're just doing this 36,000 foot overview. So when your house is in order, your fruits will testify. Right? Matthew chapter 7, 16 and 20. You shall know them by your fruits. Then you get the second witness that turns it around. By their fruits, you shall know them. So God commands our lives to testify. We are the light of the world. We are the salt of the earth. We are to let our light shine before men. We are to arise and shine, for our light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon us. Hallelujah. So, have you ever thought about Pentecost versus the marriage supper of the Lamb? So we know that Pentecost was in the morning. I know that the Holy Ghost is a morning person because he came in the morning. I'm a morning person too. Before Ruth moved out of the house, she knows I'm a morning person. I know she's a night person. So I said, I'll lay hands on you to have that morning person anointing, and you lay hands on me to have the night person anointing. Hallelujah. So in the morning time, we're very busy. But in the evening time, we're very quiet. In the morning time, we have work to do. In the evening time, the work is ended. In the morning time, we've got a full agenda. In the evening time, there's nothing left on our agenda. In the morning, we're wound up. That's why so many of you have to drink poison. I mean coffee. Or mate. Or the Jamba Juice. Whatever. Rely on the Holy Ghost. He's better than all of those. So in the morning, you're wound up. But in the evening, it's time to unwind. See, it's called the marriage supper. It's not the marriage breakfast or the marriage lunch. It's the marriage supper. So on our morning, we have a whole day we are able to fill. But on their morning, they were filled to be able to fill a whole day. So we must set our house in order and set our to-do list in order. Our source to accomplish all of our work must be found in the resources of heaven. We better be the Ephesians 5:18 filled. We better be filled first, like those in the upper room on the day of Pentecost. Filled to be able to fulfill a whole day, not having a whole day. Filled to be able to fulfill a whole day, not having a whole day we are able to fill with our busyness. So is Jesus glorified or ashamed to have you as his representative in the earth? Do you know that the lost can see right through whether or not you are a genuine or a counterfeit Christian? They can. So there are two parts to being a living epistle known and read of all men. There's a verbal witnessing, that's the part that's proceeding out of your mouth, and there's the life lived out. That life speaks the loudest. We need both. Jesus had both in his life. He taught and demonstrated to his disciples, and the disciples then in turn taught and demonstrated. Guess what? It's your turn now. If you will faithfully sow to setting your house in order so that the Lord is pleased to dwell in your house, then you will reap dwelling in his house age without end. Psalm 27:4 says, "One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all my days, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple." Psalm 37:4 says, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." It's time you set your heart and your house in order individually first. Then we can come together as members in particular and be the body of Christ as an army. We're not sending a toe, an ankle, or one ear. Every one of you is needed to fight. We want Paul's testimony in 2 Timothy 4, 7 and 8. I want you to please turn there. Come on, I didn't give you a little book in the Old Testament. We should be going a little more rapidly. I told you we're always in a hurry. It's morning. 2 Timothy 4, 7, and 8 says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. That's the abiding place. We love his appearing. He says in Psalm 5, let all those that love thee, that love your name, be joyful in thee. Yeah. Amen. Happy is the people whose God is the Lord. So Mariah Woodworth Eder had a book that was written about her life, and it was entitled Signs and Wonders. If you had a book that was written about your life, what would you like your title to be? I think I would like my title to be Days of Heaven. Days of Heaven are only possible, first and foremost, if you lay up his word in your heart and in your soul. Days of heaven is only possible if you make the living word, Christ Jesus, the one in whom you live and move and have your being in. So we are called to set our house in order. We are called to represent Jesus in the earth as Jesus is. So are we Jesus in this world. The Lord will perfect that which concerns you. Amen. Let me close with this one last verse. Philippians 1:6. But I am confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you, abiding place, shall perform it even unto the end. Amen. Pastor Daniel?
I'm going to spend a couple minutes with Jesus. I invite you to do the same.
Father, let my life be a living sacrifice for you. Just want to pour out my life on you. I love your presence, Jesus.
Let our lives just become into the divine order of heaven. The Lord says, choose you this day who you will serve. And we will say, Lord,
oh, we choose you, we serve you.
As for us, as for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. But we will truly serve. Lord, that our house has come into the order that you commanded. That we will serve not with the testimony of our lips, but with the testimony of our life, with the testimony of our hearts, with good fruit. Fruit that can be found. Fruit that when it's measured, it's found. This tree has fruit.
Oh, right now, in the name of Jesus. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I take authority over every person in this place, every mind and every heart. I command you to listen to me right now. Ha! Father, I thank you for the authority that you have placed in your church that men hate. Father, for truly you were hated. Lord Jesus, you were hated by the world. But those who know your voice, the sheep that know your voice, they hear and they respond with such a welcoming and loving heart. I take authority right now and I command every person in this place to begin to live the life of Jesus. Father, that we would set our houses in order, that we would set our lives in order. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I have a few things I want to share with you this morning. But I'm just waiting on the Holy Spirit. You know, look, it's very, I discovered a key, thank you, Lord Jesus, that when you try to do something on your own, it doesn't work out well. Why would you go and try to do a little song and dance performance when the Holy Spirit is here? Listen, I truly believe that God Himself, the Holy Spirit, God Almighty, the Lord Jesus is here in this place to change men's lives. I believe it. So I'm not just going to come up and give you a song and a dance and a few things that I prepared to share to make you laugh or whatever. There's only one thing that can change men's hearts. Look, we oftentimes spend our entire days and our lives, our weeks, begging people not to destroy their lives. It's a concept that still tweaks my thinking and blows my mind, because why would you need to beg someone not to destroy their life, right? Are you with me? But how often do we have to stand at the place of the ministers of God and say, please, will you stop making the wrong choices? Will you stop participating in sin? Will you stop living for yourself? It's only going to bring destruction. We do it. God gives us the grace to do it. And I'm saying all of this to say the power of the Holy Ghost is here in this place to help you make the right choices, to let you think differently, to allow you to think differently about yourself, that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind so that you can think differently. I'm inviting you here this morning as Pastor Joshua has ministered, as Pastor Ann has ministered, get your house in order, give a sacrifice, give your life, get things yielded to God so that you can stop destroying your life. People are hell-bent. They are stuck on living out their own life, and they think that it's good and it is acceptable to God, and I'm here to tell you today, it is not. We live a life of waste. We waste our days. We waste our time. We waste our affections on what? Temporal pleasures that mean nothing. It is wood. It is stubble. It is hay. It'll be burned up. And chances of you making heaven with your affections somewhere else, I'm here to tell you today, is very slim. God demands reality. We should demand reality. Man, I was just so broken when you spoke that out this morning. What do I have to bring to Jesus this morning? What do I have to bring to Him today? Look, my life is for Him. I sold out long ago. It is for Him. I want to live for Him every single day, more and more and more. But what do I have to bring with Him? Why should He care about what? Look, there's one thing that makes me more happier than anything is to make my wife happy and to smile and to touch her heart, to give her things, just to make her, you know, make her happy with me and just make life good, right? It's a relationship that God lays out for us and He models. Paul breaks it down for us and he says this great mystery, the mystery of the husband and the wife. And I better multiply that times eternity, what I'm bringing to Jesus. I better want to touch the heart of Jesus Christ every day. I want to move Him. I love to move my wife, just move her, to make her so happy that she would come to the point of tears, right? Just make her so joyful and giddy and smile, everything. What is it that we are giving Jesus to move His heart? We pour out our lives on ourselves. It is waste. I'm asking you today to please stop wasting your life. We waste years to get educated, to be too refined to even lift our hands in the presence of God. We work ridiculous hours doing stupid things to make a little bit of money to put into our pockets, to put into a savings account so we can retire. What on earth are you going to do with your retirement? God spoke to my heart and He told me, you do not have a savings account. I had to get rid of my savings. Look, I understand business. I'm educated in business. I've got a degree. I realize the importance of savings. Our mentality and our thinking is completely different from the thinking and the reality of God's mentality. Because men would say when Jesus is hanging on the cross, what a waste. If this man truly was the Christ, he would save himself. Oh, Jesus could have lived for so many more years. Think of how many more people Jesus could have prayed for and Jesus could have healed. What a waste. That's men's thinking. They have no understanding of the offering. They have no understanding of a life poured out for Jesus and what Jesus Christ can do with a life poured out, sacrificed completely. I'm getting somewhere with some of you this morning, and it's good. I love to close. I love to close. I work with Nicolette, and we love closing sales. Big sales, it's fun to close. Pastor Joshua labored, Pastor Ann labored. Now we get to come in, we just get to close. People, I'm ministering on offering right now. And if you think I'm after your money, I am. Because I'm after something more. I want your life. Jesus speaks to us and he says, I want your life. It has nothing to do with dollars and cents and paying the bills. It has to do with the fact of this reality. Your money and your life are linked. They're one. Because you can say all day, oh, my life is the Lord's. My life is for him. I will lay down my life. But you come before him without an offering. You hold on to those things that are really yours. I love Pastor Mark's analogy that he shared with us on Wednesday. He said, has anybody ever been at gunpoint? Right? Of course not. Has anybody been robbed? Somebody stolen your wallet or stolen something from you? It stinks to be robbed, right? And you think, oh, that thing was so valuable to me and someone just stole it. If you're at gunpoint, the decision of your life or your wallet or your life or your money, it really isn't a whole, you don't have to like list out pros and cons, right? Hold on, sir. Excuse me. I've got a pad and a pen here. Pros and cons. Well, I've got my 401k. Savings. Retirement. Ridiculous, right? It's an instant. Reach into your pocket. Here you go. Do you want my car keys as well? Please leave me alone. Let me live. Are you with me? Does this make sense to you? We value our lives more than anything. And we value our finances as much. Look, Jesus would not have highlighted the alabaster box being broken three times, three separate occasions, if it wasn't something that he wanted us to get a hold of. Because at the end of the little story, at the end of the message, at the end of the description of what took place, he said, this offering will be a memorial. Wherever the gospel is preached, this will be remembered. Why? Because it was more than just the most precious, the most valuable thing given. It was the outward demonstration of a life truly being surrendered, giving everything. Where we say, you know what, the things that have been important to me, the things that I've worked for, these things that I'm holding on to, look, do we work hard? Yes. Do we pour our lives into the things that we're doing? Yes. But it better not be about yourself and your savings and your whatever it is you want to get, your new car and a boat and the good house and whatever. It had better be about the kingdom, because the Lord Jesus clearly told us your heart, your affections, and everything that you work for, they're linked with that thing that you material possess, the material things. You better freely give them. You better freely pour them out. Jesus, I thank you that your word goes forth as a sharp razor. Look, People get upset. Oh, man, I don't have anything. I've already given. We had a message on Wednesday night, and we already poured it all out, and I don't have anything left. Don't worry about the number of it, right? The size of it. What did Jesus do? Jesus came, and he's standing over the offering basket as everybody who's got some serious wealth. In the day, look, the people of Israel were blessed. They were doing some serious sacrifices. There were, like, I mean, picture a line out the door of the bulls and the sheep and the goats and the whatever animals, right? They're bringing all this stuff. They're bringing in this gold and the silver and all of these precious things that they have. And Jesus is watching. All right, well, he didn't give much. And then the two mites show up, right? And he says, everybody stop and look at this. Two mites, I don't know what the equivalent is, like a penny, right, or something? A penny. What was the difference? It was the heart. It was everything she had. They gave out of their abundance. They gave out of their surplus. It didn't hurt at all. Pastor Summer and I God recently did this to us. We wrote out an offering, and it was too comfortable. It was like, we can afford to give that. The Lord spoke to us. He said, you got to make it hurt. You got to feel this a little bit, right? So I said, ooh, we got to feel it. I love ministering on the offering, and I love ministering on giving, because when we do, God gives us a fresh download and a fresh understanding, and these things come forth. You don't need a microphone to minister this. You don't need a microphone to get this. Your life is the ministry of this. Your life is the demonstration of this. I want to encourage you here today. Pour out your life as an offering. Pour out your life on Jesus. What is it that you have brought to him today? What is it that you have prepared in your heart, in your finances? Because they're tied. You cannot separate them. You cannot. If you ask yourself, why am I still looking the same as I did 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago? My prayer sounds the same. My worship sounds the same. I'm not reaching the lost. I'm not having any impact. You can ask yourself why. I guarantee you it is because you are stuck in how much you give. You've relegated yourself to say, I can afford to give X amount. I give my tithe, maybe, or I give this amount of offering. Most people aren't even in the realm of offering. They're barely making the cut in terms of tithe, keeping up with what is already God's. People say, well, I'm giving God this offering of my tithe. No. That already belongs to God. The 10% is already His. Are you with me? Where is the pouring out, the lavish display? It's not about how big it is. You might say, I've already given it all. I have nothing left. Reach down deep. What is it? Because I guarantee you, I promise you, I've seen it for my entire life. I've seen it over and over and over again. Those who would lavishly pour out themselves through their finances. I have to say it again because everybody gets so stuck on the money, the money, the money. And that you've heard the prosperity preachers and you've heard the next sales pitch on if you give this, you're going to get this. It's not what it's about. Look, we can go and do it. God has commissioned us, my family, people around us, network that the Lord has given us. We are sold out to preach the gospel. It will happen. I truly believe, I say this almost every time I minister, I truly believe that God looked through the spans of eternity and He said, I will put Daniel Spitsbergen right there because he will have an impact on this generation. He will have an impact on this time. I believe this. And I want you to believe it too. It's not about me. What I'm saying here is we're going to do it. We're begging you. We're asking you. We're pleading with you. Come and receive a blessing. Come and participate with this. Man, it is the only thing that will not be waste. I hate wasted potential. I hate wasting time. I hate wasting things. And I have to ask myself this morning, how much of my life has been waste? How much of my time have I wasted? What did I do this morning? God's day, we dedicate Sunday to the Lord. Every day is His, but we truly set aside Sunday for Him. What did I do when I woke up this morning to pour out my love and my affections and everything that I am on Him? He is my life, but do I truly live it? It's easy to say, I live for Jesus. You do. Can we see some numbers on that one? Can we run this? I love the man of God that said, if you were convicted of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence in a court of law to find you guilty? Too many of us have no evidence to prove that we are in any way associated with the Lord Jesus. And it must change. And I know everyone's heart in here is for it to change. That's why you're here. That's why you listen to the word. And that's why you listen to the messages that go forth that are oftentimes intense. I mean, man, I've been rocked. We got the pleasure of being with Pastor Mark and Ann in Aberdeen a couple weekends ago. Man, it was fiery. I tell you what, I am so stirred to be passionate about the things of God because the level of passion, the level of energy, the level of commitment that I've given to the Lord Jesus has been pitiful. It comes down to pitiful. And I want to change by God's help and grace. I'm going to get fiery. I'm going to get passionate about it. And I'm going to give it all because I will not stand before Him and look around and see everybody else with these offerings to give Him. And all I've got is a bunch of waste. It's wood, stubble, and hay. It's nothing to give Him. I can't present that before the King. No way, man. No way. And I want to, by the help and the grace of God, give you a moment of reality. Because we get in the 9 to 5 and Monday morning starts and we go insane. The reality of life is really manifested in the church. We can see the truth. Oh my goodness, this is what I'm living for. We touch a realm of the spirit where we can access heaven and we can feel the love and the joy and the peace and the goodness, everything that God has desired for us to live in. We can touch that in the service, and God is simply an invitation. God's simply saying, come, look, this is the realm, this is the life. But then we step out of reality and we step back into our life. Please don't do it. I'm asking you here today, end your life. Come and live the life of Christ Jesus. Do not let your life be waste. Do not continually pour out yourself for yourself. So selfish. You got to get a bigger picture of what's going on here. And I know you're getting it right now. And I know you're getting it right now because the Holy Spirit is stirring you and he's speaking to you and he's going to use your finances. It's directly correlated. Your life and your money. Your life and your money, because it's what we live for. It's what we work for. It's how we know we're going to be able to go to the store and get some food for tomorrow and fill up the gas tank so we can drive around and take care of all of the list of 1,000 things we have to do. I'm asking you this morning, what's more important to you? To live your own life? To do your own thing? You're going to die and no one will remember your name. Your own family isn't even going to remember your name. Like, that's sad to me, right? I don't know. There's a lot of my family members I don't know. My own family, they're generations away. Nobody remembers their name. Nobody remembers them. What impact, what did they do for the Lord? I want my name to be remembered for no other reason than this. He lived big for Jesus. God gives us a holy ambition. He gives us a holy passion to go and conquer the world, not for any of our own gain or any of our own fame, simply because the reality of what Jesus bought and paid for has hit our hearts. The most precious gift that heaven could afford came down to earth. He gave it all. And it's now my job to let everyone know the offering that has been given. Jesus Christ, the ultimate sacrifice, the ultimate offering, has paid it all, and he's here freely for you. He invites you in. Please, 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 I beg you, do not resist him. Do not live for yourself. It's a waste, man. It's a stinking waste. The things that we, the church building. Look, I don't know how much it costs to build this building. I know of churches that have spent millions and millions and millions to build a beautiful building, to hire these excellent musicians, to do all these great things in the name of Christendom and in the name of religion. And it's a stinking waste because people come in and there's no sincerity in their heart. There's no true worship. The Holy Spirit is nowhere near the place. It's vain words. What a waste. What a waste. If you remember, one word from me today is going to be waste. Don't waste your life. Do not waste that precious gift that God has given us, the gift of life and newness of life. He went to the nth degree. I mean, the degree we can't even fathom. He gave us his life. He said, just go live my life. Go live my life. I'm asking you here again today, if you think you've sold out, you haven't. There's more. If you think you've given it all, you haven't. There's more. If you think you are so fiery and passionate above everybody else, you're not. It's more. And what I have to do is I might be a little harsh with you this morning and letting you know there's more. Just demand reality of yourself. Just get as serious with your life as you would with your budget. And list out those things and quantify them. Where is your time and your money and your affections and your passions being spent? Because I'm here to tell you, the very harsh reality of the matter is, it's been for ourselves and God wants it to change. It's not a message of condemnation. It's a message of liberation because God says, look, the light shines. You can now clearly see. If you're blindfolded, if you're in a dark room and you can't see, you can't figure out what's going on. He says, I've got the light. Look, you can now clearly see. You can now clearly discern what's going on and you are empowered to make the right decision. None of us in a conscious state will choose death over life, right? But we do it because we become tempted, immersed in a place where we can't see. We've allowed Satan to blind us. Where we make it is a conscious decision, but we don't see clearly. Stick with me. We choose to sin. We choose to disobey God. But if we would be able to see the whole picture and say, oh my goodness, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Disobedience to the Father is going to result in destruction every time. If we could have that 30,000 foot view. Look, man, how do I get this? You got to get this. And I know you've got a concept of it, but I want to hit your heart with it because it's more than just an intellectual concept. It's something that goes in your spirit. If you let the Holy Ghost so take over your desires, so take over everything that you are, you see clearly. I know every person in here wants this, because who could refuse life? Who would refuse life? Who would refuse to live in all of the goodness that God would pour out? Love and joy and peace and goodness, long-suffering, temperance, patience, meekness. Everything that we want in other people to be towards us, right? God wants it to be in us towards everyone. Become givers. Radical, passionate, lavishly displaying, offering givers. With it, everything that you have need of will follow. It's a side note for me. It's a side note because I'm not here to give. I'm not here to manipulate God into giving me a blessing. Your heart's not right. Right? We can see examples throughout the word of people that heart wasn't right. It doesn't work out. You want your heart to be right. It's simply saying, Father, I have been confessing the name of Jesus. I have been claiming that I live for Christ Jesus, and the reality is it has been nothing but waste. If you look, God's not interested in the long, drawn out, lengthy worded prayers. He's simply looking for a little bit of reality. A simple, Lord, where am I wasting? Father, what have I done that is waste? What have I done that counts? What am I doing on a daily basis that has eternal significance? If it doesn't have eternal significance, if it does not meet the litmus test of eternity, it's waste. It's waste. And I'm asking you here today, first and foremost, I want your life. I want your life. Because I do not want any person in here under the sound of my voice to spend eternity without God. Eternity in a place called hell that is truly an eternal torture chamber that was not designed for men. But men choose on a daily basis to have hell. They choose hell. They create hell for their own lives. And then they will, at the end, spend eternity in a place absent and away from God in torment and pain. I don't want that for any person in here. My heart and my prayer is that I can reach as many people for the kingdom to save as many souls as is possible. What I'm telling you here today in this place, for those of you who have met Jesus and have surrendered your life to Him, don't stop short. Do not have false finish lines, because we can so easily become comfortable and complacent. And the book of Revelation has a word for it: lukewarm. And the Father is not going to abide it. He will spit it out and He will say, depart from me. You are lukewarm. I don't like lukewarm. You got to be radically passionate, hot. It's not a one-time thing either. You might say, look, we just heard this message on Wednesday and we gave. I don't expect a one-time kiss from my wife, right? Wedding day, got a kiss. I'll see you. That was a great kiss. Great offering. Thank you for that. That would be silly. I want a daily offering of her kisses. I want a daily offering of her hugs and her love and her affection and a lavish display, and I plan to give her that every day. Are you with me? Why would we look at the Lord Jesus and come to Him and say, Lord Jesus, I accept You, wash me, cleanse me, restore me, give me a new heart and give me a new spirit, and then see ya? We do it. Every single day, there must be an offering. There must be a lavish display of affection and of emotion and of praise and thanksgiving. And when we're in the house of God, we have an opportunity to give of those things that are most precious. You can say that this is most precious and that's most precious. Your money is. Your money is most precious. Say, oh, no, my dog is most precious. You do not go and spend 8 hours a day with your dog, waiting on them hand and foot and doing everything, right? Oh, well, this is most precious. It's not. Our money. Why? Because it's the means by how, it's how we live. It's how we pay for things, right? It's how we do, live life. Father says, I want you to forsake your life. Come and live my life. Man, it is intense. I've been listening to Pastor Mark and reading Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. And every single day, it hits me. Jesus, did you have to be so radical with this? I mean, everything, unless I hate father and mother and brothers and sisters, unless I forsake everything, I'm not worthy of the kingdom? Did you have to be so radical with it? Yes. Because if we allow anything to have that pull on our heart, if it's not 100% sold out for him, man, Satan is tricky. He's slippery. He's the smartest idiot I know. Listen, he looks for the littlest hold, the littlest toe hold, the littlest finger hold in our lives. Just that point, call it 0.01%. If he's got that, man, he's got the ability to reach in there and pull your affections away and pull your passions away and pull you away. That is why Jesus Christ demands 100% sold out, nothing else, forsake your life, end all, and live his life. And he allows us to be real with ourselves, to be real with him. And we can say, bank account, does my life reflect that I'm living for Jesus? There's one company in the world that has 100% accuracy on inventory. Does anybody know what it is? No, a natural company. 100%. Look, we have a manufacturing company. If we're coming in around 90%, we're stoked. 100% accuracy. It's a bank. Every transaction, right? Every penny is accounted for. Every bit of inventory, your cash dollar bills, is accounted for. That's great when you've got something that you can look at that says, wow, we've got 100% accuracy. There are errors. You know, stick with me. Don't go. You can look at it and you can say, here's a litmus test. Here's an evaluation. With a good percentage of accuracy, I can say, my life is giving X amount for me. It's giving X amount for the kingdom. The Lord wants everything. He wants your money. He wants your life. Most importantly, he wants your life. If I can get something across to you this morning, it will be this. They're linked. They're tied. It's our affections. It's what we work for. It's what we do. We want it all to be spent on him. Otherwise, it's waste. Spend it all on him. Everything we do. When I go to work, when I clock in, man, it's for the kingdom. I'm working for the kingdom. I'm so blessed to work for a company whose vision and purpose is to finance missions, is to finance crusades, is to send the message of Jesus Christ around the world. I can truly say, my company, this is what we're doing. This is what I get to work for. It's a blessing. Thank you, Nicolette. I get to say, when I'm doing these other things, when Summer and I are out on the Mission Training Center, when we're doing things, we're not just trying to build something for ourselves and a cool place to live. We truly believe that we are going to raise up more missionaries from out of this place than anywhere else in the world. And we're doing the basic things that will empower people to understand horticulture and agriculture and animal husbandry and fisheries, all these things that are so fun and practical where we can go and we can feed them. Because look, you go overseas and you've got food, we can do it here. James and Sandy just went, you have food, you have something to give away, people show up. More importantly, the message of the gospel. But you got to get them there. You got to have a point of contact. For most people, they don't get it, right? People need something to break the ice. Food's a great way. I have discovered one of the silliest, I would have never imagined, evangelistic tools in the world. Does anybody have a problem evangelizing? Be honest, it's hard for you to walk up to someone on the street and break the ice. Does anybody have that? Thank you for honest people, because everyone does. If you didn't, you would have this place jam-packed. Who has problems going and talking to people? Okay? I've got a recommendation for you. Over the past 4 weeks, I have talked to more people on the street than I probably have in most of my life. I got a puppy. If you walk your puppy down the street, people will come from across the way. They will make a beeline for you to hold your puppy and talk about your puppy. And it is an open door to evangelize. It is ridiculous. My mom, we had an event over the weekend. We were out. My mom was with us. And she's like, everyone stops. Yeah. Everybody stops. Okay? I know this is a bit of a tangent, but I want you to get this. There's too many tools. There's too many things that we have around us where we can reach people. Food is one of them that we see as clear. Everybody's going to eat. They got to eat. Okay? So we're pouring out our lives into those things that we're doing for the mission. Look, you've got so many areas to give. You all need to be excessively rich. Okay? And the only way you're going to do it is to give yourself into a blessing. Because I hate to break it to you. You're 9 to 5, 60K a year, isn't cutting it. 80K, maybe you're 100, 120. I got any 2,000s? It's not going to cut it. The Lord needs more because we've got the local church to give into. Look, to be able to pour out those outreaches. How many of you guys did the outreach? It was last weekend. Beautiful. It is so awesome to be able to continually do those outreaches. You could do them every single day and people would show up. It takes resources, the local church, to take care of the needs of everything that is in the house. And then we're giving to church plants. Pastor Summer and I know some of you might have heard a rumor that we left the church and we were upset at Pastor Mark. I'm here to tell you that's not true. This is our home church. We are linked with the abiding place. We were sent out because God put a fire within our bones to go out and minister the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why he chose Bly, Oregon, I'm not sure, but it's a mission field and we love it. We're planning a church. We need resources. We need finances. We've got stuff to do. It's not waste. I guarantee you, I will demand of myself that the message of the Holy Ghost, the fire of the Holy Spirit, the words of Jesus will be ministered through our lives. And as soon as they are not, we will quit and we'll go figure it out. But I commit to you that this church plant that we're doing, it's not about us. It's about reaching the lost. It's not about giving us a platform and a microphone and fame and fortune. I mean, if we wanted fame and fortune, we wouldn't have gone to Bly. Of the church plants. Pastor Mark, the doors have been open for many, many years. Look, don't think that Pastor Mark's just now getting invitations to go and travel around the United States to preach. Many, many years. He's waited on the Lord to release him, and he's been released. And then there are some incredible things. I mean, the outbreak of the Holy Ghost that was in, I think that was the first one we've done with you is Aberdeen. Amazing. The lives touched, the miracles, and it's kind of gets me sometimes. Irritating because we walk in the place, the blind see, the deaf hear, the crippled walk, the miracles of Jesus, they take place. I'm like, man, what's the holdup? I know there's miracles needed in the abiding place. What's the holdup? What's the holdup? We got to get a hold of this. We got to sell out. We got to stop listening to the word and not paying up. This is closing time right here. Are you with me? Close the close. It's time to pay up. You better pay up with your life. Don't stop short, because if you come in here and you say, oh man, that was really cool what Joshua did. He danced around. He did a song. Pastor Ann shared some good stuff. Great analogies. I love the story she told. And then there was a great finish too. Man, that was wonderful. Wasn't that wonderful today? And that's the extent of it. You wasted the day. You should have gone to the beach. Don't waste this morning. Don't waste this opportunity. Do not waste this encounter with the living God right now. Because he says, pay up. He says, pay up. Come with your heart. With your heart, you can come and you can pour out and you can say, Holy Spirit, I ask you right now to let the floodlight of heaven shine upon my soul. Oh, search me, oh God. See if there be any wicked way in me. Father, see if there be any waste in me. Let my heart be bare before you. Let it be open, wide, wide open before you for you to come and reprove and to rebuke and to exhort and to change. Because that's what he wants, the reality of his life in you. That's what he demands. Do not allow waste in your life. Get rid of it. It stinks. Waste stinks. Father, I thank you for every sincere and true heart in here who is with lifted hands and wide open hearts cries out to you to say, Father, bring change in me. Oh, Father, let my accounting be accurate. Father, let the accounting of my life truly be that which reflects a life lived for you. Father, I thank you that every bit of deception that has been allowed, every little justification and mind game that we play with ourselves, Father, that it would be broken, that we could see truly where we are spending our lives, whether we spend it on you or whether we spend it on ourselves. Everyone, I want you to please stand with me. I didn't get to what I was going to share fully, but the Holy Spirit is doing a much better job than I could ever come up with. So I want you right now to prepare an offering of your finances and an offering of your heart. Because as we come, we're going to give, but I want you to come up in expectation to receive from the Father here this morning. Because, oh, the Father is most interested in your heart. Oh, He is most interested in your affections. He wants your life. He wants everything that you are. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you that you place in every person in here's heart this command, that they would never appear before you empty-handed, that they would never appear before you without an offering. Every single day, may these words haunt them. What have you brought to Jesus? What is it that you have given to Jesus? Oh, Father, let the reality of your presence, of your existence, of your being in us be so real in the name of Jesus. So real. Oh, the reality must be confronted every day. Oh, Father, I thank you that your Holy Spirit just haunts in a wonderful and precious way. Oh, that it just so overwhelms us. Such a God-conscious state, so conscious of you in us and us in you, this fellowship and this oneness, this relationship that you so freely gave. Oh, Father, I thank you that you are so merciful. Oh, that you are so full of long-suffering that you would forgive us for giving you a cold shoulder. Oh, Father, that you would forgive us for being bad representatives, that you would forgive us for living for ourselves, and you would allow us to have another opportunity and another chance to say, Father, oh, I want my life to be hid in you, Christ Jesus. Oh, I want my life to end for myself. Oh, and to be lived out for you. Father, I ask you right now, in the name of Jesus, everyone that has prepared a financial gift, I thank you that you are moving upon it now, that you would bring great wealth into their hands, that you would bring great prosperity and great blessing so that they could be a blessing to others, so that the message of the gospel can be shared throughout the world. Father, so that the local church can be financed. Oh, Father, so that church plants can be financed for the message of the traveling evangelists, for those messages that would go throughout the United States. And Father, for the crusades around the world. Oh, the missions around the world. The mass evangelism around the world would be financed through us. Father, I ask that every person would take upon their shoulders the weight of financing the gospel. To look, I mean, if you get a hold of that, if it's your job, I told this to Brian. Where's Brian at? Standing in the back. I was ministering to him one day, and I said, Brian, what are you doing? I said, what if it was your job? He was 10 at the time. I said, what if it was your job to reach every 10-year-old in the entire world? You have to reach your generation. It's on you. What would you do? How would you live? You live different. We have to take this mandate upon ourselves. What if it was our job, us, individually, to reach our generation, to reach every person in our age group? Man, it's impossible. How could you do that? Guess what? We serve a God who makes the impossible possible. To finance that, to take on the brunt, to shoulder the responsibility of, I must finance the gospel. I must reach the lost. It takes money. Most importantly, it takes your life. If you are on a mission to raise $1 million right now for the kingdom, and you don't give tithe and you don't give offerings, you're fooling yourself. You're working for yourself, and it's a joke, and you'll never give. Break that mentality. I don't care where you're at, what's in your hand right now. If it is not all for the kingdom, if you cannot right now at the drop of a hat, empty your bank account. Write a check for every dollar and every penny in your account. You're fooling yourself. Every single day. You don't think that you're going to get to a point of, oh, if I could get to $100,000 in my bank account, I could give, you know, a big offering. If I could get to $1 million, then I could give a big offering. No, you never will. If you have 10 bucks in your account and you can give a big offering of 10 bucks, you got something. If you got 100 bucks in your account and you can give everything, you can give 100 bucks, yeah, you can do something. Again, it's not about the dollars. It's about the heart. Remember the two mites. She gave out of her necessity. She needed that. That was it. That's everything she had. That was her heart. I want you to give your heart fully to the Lord. I want you to give your life fully to the kingdom. I want you to sell out and stop living for yourself. That's my heart. That's my call. That's my cry. That is what Jesus has put in my mouth. The Holy Spirit has put in my mouth to ask you. Because there is a needy world out there. I don't know if you've looked around recently, but there are some people in serious need. I'm sick and tired of praying for people and them not get healed. It has nothing to do with the Father. He's ready to heal. Where is it that I'm holding on to my life where He can't fully use me? Because this is the reality. God has commissioned us to go everywhere, laying our hands on the sick, and they will recover. If there is a problem with the recovery, I can't point to anybody else but me. And I'm asking the Father, where am I holding back? What am I holding on to? Where is my life not sold out for you? Where am I wasting? The alabaster box was called a waste, right? Men's logic and men's opinion is, what a waste. No, it was not. It was poured out on Jesus. Let me tell you this. Anytime you pour out an offering on Jesus, it's not a waste. You may have other voices and thoughts saying, oh, what a waste. You just wasted that. You needed that to pay your bills. What a waste. No, it wasn't a waste. The alabaster box that was cracked open to be poured out on Jesus was not a waste. The Pharisees in the one account, the disciples in the other account, on two of the accounts saying, oh, this could have been sold and given to the poor. What a waste. No. When you give your gift, when you give your offering on the most precious one, I guarantee you it'll never be a waste. And don't let thoughts of fear come in and mess with you. Don't let thoughts of your human thinking and your human realm, oh, if I do it, I'm not going to be able to, and if I do it, that messes up everything. God is inviting us to a realm of faith that we can step out and walk on the water, where we can step out and live for Him in such a way where we would confront people and tell them about the reality of the gospel. I love that. I'd never heard Pastor Mark say that before. I think he said it before, but I missed it. Where the word for witness and the word for martyr being the same word, that same Greek word, where you're ready to give up your life. It's your life's over. If you're going to be a witness, it's the same as if you're going to, you're going to go tell somebody about the Lord, and the chances of them shooting you are high. Chances of them killing you are high. When there's that resolve, it's easy, right? When you've already committed to say, we can go anywhere, we can talk and preach and confess the name of Jesus, whether we live or whether we die, then everything else is easy. But we can trick ourselves, man. We play these games. Oh, I could do that. I could do that. No, you couldn't. Can you write the check for the entirety of the bank account? Then no, you couldn't, because that's what's precious to you. That's what we have as the tangible reality of it, as it were, right? To say, this is what I count dear to myself. Can you pour it out? Can you break open that alabaster box and pour it out upon the Lord? Can you give Him everything? Look, that was the savings. That was the retirement. That was like the fallback plan. That was the stored up treasure, right? The alabaster box. Pour it out. I'm asking you again here this morning. Will you pour it out? Will you pour it out? Look, Abiding Place is known throughout the world. Is this true? They're known throughout the world for their lavish giving. I'm going to just spend a second. I don't think I've ever said this. I don't think anybody's ever said it. Abiding Place in often cases has set the bar. Well, they don't give like the Abiding Place. I'm telling you. This is kind of a behind-the-scenes look. I've heard the ministers around the world talking in the back room and say, well, they don't give like the Abiding Place, right? It's an honor. You guys give, and you lavishly give. But the one-time kiss isn't enough. One hug isn't enough. It's every single day, every single meeting, lavish, lavish, lavish giving, lavish display of emotion, of passion, and worship. It'll break you through. This is what I'm trying to get across. It'll break you through. You'll worship like you haven't ever worshiped before. You'll dance around and you'll praise and you'll sing and you will shout with complete abandonment like you never have before. No longer will you be so bottled up, as Pastor Joshua was saying. No longer will you hold it all in with wide, wide open arms and wide open heart. It's just poured out. Pastor's not going to have to tell you to, come on, guy, get up and move around and dance and worship the King of Kings. It's already there because you've poured out everything. You've poured it all out. You're not going to hold anything back. If you feel that you have held back, if you feel that there's something holding you in and you don't want to shout it out, right, where's Caleb at? One time we were in youth, I told Caleb, you need a breakthrough right now. Caleb, you've got to shout. Shout, Caleb. He's like, Jesus. I was like, that's terrible. Shout. And then it got stronger and stronger and he broke through. And then it was a good night for you, right? There was a breakthrough in it. Because you were too bottled up in all of your own, it was a tough day at school and mom was upset at me and I don't know, right? It was a tough day at work and the boss yelled at me. Oh, it was a tough day at home. Get out of yourself. If you will lavishly give it all, oh man, he can lavishly pour into you. I want you to get this. I want you to get this. Thank you, Father. Just waiting on the Holy Spirit because I know there's some good things happening. We love Pastor Stone and I love when we get to come down here and be with you and just fellowship with you and get encouraged and the word spoken out because there's an atmosphere of faith that is in this place. It is just supercharged with the power of God. Why would we stop short? Why, when we have all of heaven backing us up, why would we settle out? Why would we stop short? That is just silly. Let's not be silly. Let's not waste. If you have an offering, I want you to raise it up. We're going to pray over it right now. Father, you see these hearts that are lavishly displaying and lavishly pouring out this offering. I ask you in the name of Jesus for supernatural multiplication. Father, for divine abundance to be poured out. Father, that it doesn't even make sense in the bank account, the dollars in to the dollars available. Father, that there be divine, supernatural multiplication for the church to finance the message of the gospel and for your people to be blessed in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the gift of faith that is moving upon these people's hearts. Father, for the gift of faith that is being stirred to see wealth created. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. I want you to come give, and as you do, I see the Holy Ghost moving upon many of your hearts. I want you to come up here and stand, and we're going to pray with you. The Holy Spirit is touching your heart, and you're saying, I want to surrender more. Oh, I want to give my heart in such a radical, new, lavish display. I want you to stand up here. We're going to pray for you. We're going to minister because the Father is doing something in this place that is beautiful, that is wonderful. Father makes wealth. We got something recently. We think, oh, well, we're going to go and we're going to make wealth for the kingdom. We're going to do this. No, you're not. Father makes wealth. Father gives the blessing. Father creates it. Out of nothing he spoke and his word created. Out of nothing he speaks and his word creates. Oh, thank you, Father, for this people that is hungry, that is thirsty, that is desperate for your presence, for your glory, for your reality. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Father, I thank you that you stir in our hearts such a desperation to seek you daily, to seek you in prayer, to seek you in the word. Oh, to find that secret place where we can touch heaven. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, glory to the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
House, we will serve the Lord, we will honor him. Me and my house, we will serve the Lord, we will honor him. For me and my house, we will serve you, Lord, we will honor him. For me and my house, we will serve you, Lord, we will honor you. house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. For me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. For me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. Oh, as for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. It says for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. Oh, as for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. My house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. It's for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. Me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. We will honor you. It says for me and my house, we will serve you. We will honor you. And we will serve you. We will serve you. We will serve. We will serve. We will serve. We will serve. As for me and my house, we will serve you. We will honor you. Just as for me and my house, we will serve you. We will honor you. Just as for me and my house, we will serve you. We will honor you. We will honor you. Oh, as for me and my house, we will serve you. We will honor you. As for me and my house, we will serve you. We will honor you. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. As for me and my house, we will serve you. We will serve you, Lord. We will honor. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will honor you. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. We will thank you. this whole world. Just give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. All I want is Jesus. You can take this whole world. Just give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. Just give me Jesus. You can take this whole world. Just give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. Just give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. Just give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. Just give me Jesus. Well, you can have this whole world. Just give me Jesus. You can have this whole world. You can have this whole world. Just give me Jesus. Well, you can have this whole world. Just give me Jesus. All we want is you, Jesus. All we need is you, Jesus. All we want is you, Jesus. All we need is you, Jesus. All we want is you, Jesus. All we need is you, Jesus. All we want is you, Jesus. All we need is you, Jesus. Oh, you can take this whole world. Just give me Jesus. You can take this whole world. Just give. Take this whole world, just give me Jesus. All I want is my Savior, all I want is my Redeemer. Just wanna be with the one my soul loves. Just wanna be with the lover of my soul. Just wanna be with Jesus. Just wanna be with my Savior. Just wanna be. Take this whole world, just give me Jesus. You can take this whole world, just give me Jesus. Or you can take this whole world, just give me Jesus. You can take this whole world, just give me Jesus. All I want is you, Jesus. Take up my cross and follow you, Jesus. flock, take up my cross, and follow you, Jesus. With you is life and joy and peace everlasting. With you is life and joy and peace that fades not away. With you is life and joy and peace everlasting. With you is life and joy and peace fades not away. With you is life and joy and peace everlasting. With you is life and joy and peace that fades not away. With you is life and joy and peace everlasting. With you is life and joy and peace that fades not away. With you is life and joy and peace everlasting. With you is life and joy and peace that fades not away. With you is life and joy and peace everlasting. With you is life and joy and peace that fades not away. With you is life and joy and peace everlasting. With you is life and joy and peace and faith. So here I'll stay. Here I'll stay. I've made you my stay, my habitation, my dwelling place. Life and joy and peace everlasting. In you is life and joy and peace that fades not away. In you is life and joy and peace everlasting. In you is life and joy and peace that fades. All else will fade, but you remain. All else will fade, but you remain. And in you is life and joy and peace everlasting. In you is life and joy and peace fades not. In you is life and joy and peace everlasting. Life and joy and life and joy and peace everlasting. In you is life and joy and peace that fades not. In you is life and joy and peace everlasting. In you is life and joy and peace fades.
abiding in the vine. I am my beloved and he is mine. I'm abiding in the vine. Oh, I am my beloved and he is mine. I'm abiding in the vine. Oh, I am my beloved and he is mine. I'm abiding in the vine. Oh, I am my beloved and he is mine. I'm abiding in the vine. I am my beloved and he is mine. Abiding in the vine. Oh, I am my beloved and he is I'm abiding in the vine. I am my beloved and he is mine. Abiding in the vine. I am my beloved and he is mine. Abiding in the vine. I am my beloved and he is mine.
Father is so good to us. He is so wonderful. He is so worthy to be praised.
Go and live for Him today. Be a witness of Him to everyone that you encounter. Keep your affections on things above. Keep everything in heaven and live heaven every day. We're going to be back here tonight at 6 o'clock. It is going to be powerful. Come with a conscious, ready mind to pour out your offering upon Him, to pour out your worship upon Him, to give Him your praise. Let the Lord touch you tonight. I am so excited for what God is going to do. I mean, we take for granted too often the encounters that we have with God. Knowing that God is going to be in this place, the word will be delivered, His presence will be here for our lives to be changed. Come excited and full of thanksgiving and praise and worship. Stay as long as you want if you're here in this place. Linger. Linger in the house of God. Linger. Dwell. Stay for a long time. Otherwise, you can consider yourselves dismissed. If anybody we missed, if there's anybody else that needs prayer, come and we'll pray for you. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you. Hallelujah.
Fighting in the fire.